Welcome to this lecture about electricity production. Buildings need electricity to power lighting and appliances. Additionally, many modern heating and cooling energy systems are powered by electricity, and the way this electricity is generated determines for a large part resource depletion and CO2 emissions. It is therefore important to get a basic understanding of the different systems in use. This is the first lecture about electricity production, and it will be mainly about how hot gases or steam produced by the combustion of fuels are the drivers of electricity production. Of course, we want to get rid of fossil fuel systems, but as they cover more than 60% of all electricity production, it is relevant to have some kind of understanding of the processes involved. And we will also see that the fossil fuels used may be replaced by more sustainable resources like biogas or biomass. We are going to address shortly combustion engines, followed by gas turbines, and we will end with the steam turbines. Contrary to what is indicated in the table, we will handle geothermal steam in another lecture, together with wind and hydropower. But first, we need to know how electricity is produced. About 200 years ago, Faraday discovered electromagnetic induction. If a wire of conductive material like copper moves within a magnetic field, it induces a flow of electrons in the wire. A flow of electrons is electricity, and the electricity is then delivered to the grid. You see in the picture the magnet with its two poles, north and south, surrounding the wire. The wire rotates and therefore moves, so electricity is induced. So you need only three things. First, a wire of conductive material. In power plant, big coils like in the figure below are used. Second, you need a magnet like on this picture, but much bigger. A magnet is a ferromagnetic material like iron, nickel or ferrite. These materials produce from themselves or with some processing a permanent magnetic field. The voltage produced is given by Faraday's law. Voltage is velocity of the rotating coil times length of the wire L in the coil times magnetic field B times sinus theta, where theta is the angle between the wire and the magnetic field. The magnetic field is vertical from North Pole to South Pole, and as the coil is rotating all time, the angle theta changes all time, creating a sinusoidal voltage, so-called AC, alternating current. How does that relate to the electrical power created? You may remember from a lecture on electrical heating that power is the square of voltage divided by the resistance. So, depending on the resistance of the wire, diverse powers will be generated. And that brings us to the third point. We need something to rotate the coil or wire. In the ideal case, the mechanical power needed to rotate the coil is equal to the generated electrical power. That's the law of conservation of energy. But of course, there are losses like friction or field losses, and typical efficiencies of this process are around 0.8 to 0.9. But how are we going to manage to deliver this mechanical power that makes the rotor rotate? That is where our combusting gas and steam engines come. They are just meant as a way to rotate the coil. The basic idea is to use the kinetic and potential energy of hot gases or steam for rotation. Let's start with the first system, the combustion engine. In a combustion engine, fossil fuel or biogas or even hydrogen is burned directly in the engine, making a piston move. The piston is connected to the rotor by a rod, and as the piston moves, it rotates the rotor. This is exactly the same principle as the gasoline or diesel motor of a car. You see, left an example used as backup generator for a factory, and right a portable engine. Let's look on the example of a four-stroke engine, how it works. First, remember that to burn a fuel, you need air. First, air and fuel are forced into the cylinder, pushing the piston down by which the rotor starts rotating. When the piston is at its lowest position, the intake of air and fuel at the valves are closed. The second step makes use of the inertia of the rotor by which it keeps rotating, pushing the piston upwards again, compressing this way the mixture of air and fuel. The third step starts when the piston is at its highest position. The mix is then ignited by a spark, realizing a mini explosion. The fuel-air mixture burns, generating heat and exhaust gases by which the pressure increases, pushing the piston down again and gives it enough momentum, what we call the inertia in step two, for the three other steps. When the piston is at its lowest position again, the valves above are opened, allowing for the exhaust fumes to leave the cylinder. This way, the pressure decreases and the piston goes up again and the cycle starts again. Of course, all these fumes released in the outdoor air contain CO2 and harmful combustion products, as we have seen in an earlier lecture. Some of them can be filtered, of course. And what about the efficiency? The mechanical efficiency in the generator is about 0.9. There are also losses from the rotor to the shaft and losses from the piston to the rotor, both efficiencies being around 0.95. But the main losses take place in the combustion chamber, where the thermal energy of the burning fuel is transferred into energy moving the piston. It is possible to calculate the maximum efficiency of this conversion process, eta-conv, depending on the exact cycle. In practice, it is between 0.35 and 0.45. So, what is the total efficiency of producing electricity with a combustion engine? Well, let's take a good one with eta-conv is 0.45. The total efficiency is 0.45 times all mechanical losses, 2 times 0.9 and 1 times 0.9, which brings us to 0.36. Of course, depending on the technology and fuel used, it may be a bit lower or higher. So, 36% of the fuel's energy content can be converted to electricity. In the combustion chamber itself, we have seen that 45% of the higher heating value is converted to piston energy. What happens with the remaining part? Well, around 30% is lost through the hot exhaust gases, and the rest heats the cylinder itself that must be cooled down. Typical temperature in the combustion chamber are around 2500-3000 degrees Celsius, depending on the specific fuel, and this must be reduced strongly to 150 to 200 degrees to not damage the lubricating oil and equipment. A heat exchanger is therefore placed around the cylinder, taking the heat away and releasing it to the environment, air, water, or much better, heating applications like district heating. In this case, we speak about cogeneration. The engine has produced at the same time electricity and useful heat. These combustion engines can start very quickly and are often used in portable applications or as backup power in case of failure of the grid in hospitals or data centers, for instance. And there are also competitors of the gas and steam turbines used in large power plants that we are going to handle next. There is also a noticeable renewed interest in these combustion engines as they can be powered by hydrogen instead of gas, gasoline or fuel oils. A combustion engine powered by hydrogen has no CO2 emissions, as you may remember from an earlier lecture. If the hydrogen is not produced by fossil fuel, of course. Hydrogen technology will be the subject of another lecture. Let's look now at turbine technology. The basic idea here is to connect a turbine to the coil's rotor. If we are able to inject high-pressure gas in the turbine, and to expand it towards lower pressures, the gas will impact the blades of the turbine with a high velocity, making it rotate. How do we get this high pressure gas? Well, here too, that will be by burning a fuel, generally gas, but also coal, liquid fuels, biofuels, or hydrogen again. But this time by making use of the exhaust gases. The higher the pressure of the gas, the more energy it contains. So instead of burning the gas at atmospheric pressure, like we do in a domestic boiler, the combustion will now take place at higher pressure and therefore also at a high temperature. You already know that air is needed for combustion, so the point here is to first compress air at a high pressure and then to burn the gas with this air in a boiler at high pressure, which we call a combustion chamber. By the way, it can also be burning of coal or anything else. Then the warm pressurized combustion gases are led to the turbine where they expand, giving their energy to the turbine blades, which start rotating at the right side, the rotor of the generator, and at the left side, the rotor of the compressor. So this compressor needs no electricity as it is powered by the turbine itself. Of course, at the start that is not possible as there is no gas yet, so a start motor is used to action the compression during the first 15 minutes. The exhaust gases in the turbine are released to the atmosphere, such as the purple pipe below the turbine, with the CO2 and other harmful products they contain if the fuel is a fossil fuel and contains carbon. Of course, there are all kinds of filters installed nowadays, but the CO2 still goes out. But here too, green fuels can be used like hydrogen. There may also be a heat exchanger, generally coupled to a cooling tower and placed at the exhaust side of the turbine, like you see on the figure. It can this way recover heat that can be used somewhere else, for instance for district heating, or to further preheat the compressed air before it comes into the combustion chamber. And finally, there are also gas turbines that operate in a closed cycle, meaning that the exhaust gases that consist of air for a large part are refilled to the compressor. As for the efficiency of the gas turbine, here too there are mechanical losses in the generator, plus mechanical losses in the turbine's rotor, and of course the conversion losses between the energy contained by the fumes and the maximum mechanical power of the rotor. It can be shown that this maximum conversion efficiency is the temperature difference between the supply gas temperature to the turbine and the exhaust temperature divided by the supply temperature. But more than half of the rotor energy is used by the compressor, so only half goes to the generator. In an optimistic case, eta conv is then 0.5. It is often called the turbine efficiency. And additionally, we have the losses in the compressor. Generally, eta is here around 0.85. And losses in the combustion chamber, which are the heat delivered by the fumes divided by the higher heating value of the fuel, around 0.96. So the total efficiency of electricity production with this turbine is 0.36. You see here left an example of a large turbine and right above a more realistic scheme of the working principle. You see here that the combustion chamber does not really look like a boiler, and you see also that the compressor is coupled to the same shaft as the generator, using a part of the energy delivered by the hot gases to the turbine. Below, a cooling tower used to cool the heat exchanger. These gas turbines can be found in very diverse powers, from small to large. Let's switch now to the steam turbine. It is quite similar to the gas turbine, except that this time not the exhaust combustion gases are circulated, but steam produced with the boiler. You see that there is a heat exchanger in the boiler in which water is circulated and heated to high pressure steam. After expansion in the turbine, the steam is further condensed in a heat exchanger and the obtained water is pumped again to the heat exchanger in the boiler. The heat delivered in the heat exchanger is either lost in outdoor air or may be used in other applications like district heating. Steam turbines are generally smaller than gas ones. Let's look at their efficiency now. The efficiency of the boiler is high, as usual, around 0.96. As the turbine is not connected to a compressor but only to the generator, we could expect it to have a higher efficiency ηComv than the gas turbine. However, the temperature of the steam and therefore the energy it contains is much less than in a gas turbine, so the blades rotate more slowly and less power is converted, resulting to a conversion efficiency of 0.5 at the best. So in the end, we come here to an efficiency of 0.41 if we neglect the pump efficiency, the pump energy. In a nuclear plant, it works exactly the same, only the combustion chamber is replaced by a nuclear reactor and there is one heat exchanger more to make sure radioactive elements remain into the protective shell. You may remember another lecture where the energy content of uranium appeared to be 80 gigajoules per kilogram. This is enormous, and these nuclear plants deliver generally very large quantities of carbon-free electricity. Unfortunately, there is nuclear waste and a lot of risks due to radiation if control is lost on the reactor and after end of service life of the plant. Finally, we must name the so-called combined cycle gas turbine, which in fact is a very efficient combination of a gas turbine and a steam turbine in which the heat from the warm exhaust gas from the gas turbine is used instead of a boiler to produce steam for a second turbine. This way, two turbines are driven with one quantity of fuel instead of two, and two generators are producing electricity. So, the efficiency of such a combined cycle is much higher than in a single cycle. You remember that in the examples given, the electrical efficiency of the gas turbine was 0.35 and the one of the steam turbine was 0.41. Unfortunately, both efficiencies do not add to 0.76 as the fumes out of the gas turbine have a bit higher temperatures than usual to ensure a good heat exchange in the heat exchanger, and the steam produced has also a bit lower temperatures than in a usual steam turbine. So the efficiency decreases here too. But all in all, electrical efficiencies above 0.6 can be achieved. This is the reason why most modern power plants use this combined cycle. In this lecture, you have discovered how electricity is made by converting thermal energy from fuel combustion into work on a rotor into electricity. This is a chain, and in each part of the chain, energy is lost. First, electricity is generated in a generator by rotating a coil of conductive wire in a magnetic field. Then, engines and turbines are used to rotate the rotor connected to the coil. In a combustion engine, fuel combustion delivers energy acting on the pistons coupled to the rotor. In a gas turbine, the exhaust combustion gases rotate a turbine coupled to the rotor. And finally, in a steam turbine, combustion is used to make steam, which rotates a turbine coupled to the rotor. The total efficiency of electricity production is the product of the efficiencies of all these sub-processes. The combustion process itself is quite efficient, around 0.9 or above. The conversion from heat to rotor rotation is much less efficient, being around 0.5. There is a theoretical maximum to this conversion efficiency depending on the temperature levels. And then there are the mechanical losses, the most important ones taking place in the generator itself. In total, the efficiency of such systems is between 0.25 for the poor ones and 0.45 for the good ones. However, with combined cycles, the efficiency can increase above 0.6. And finally, although most of these devices still use fossil fuels, all kinds of fuels could be used, including biofuels, biogas, and even hydrogen. Thank you for your attention.